Welcome everyone. Hope you are already attending all the sessions and enjoying this conference. I and Harshit are here to present on a topic which is a little bit sensitive. So, and it is very broad topic. So obviously we cannot cover it in a specific period of time, but we try to highlight few of the specific key areas where you can work on and contribute. So this EWN segment, you can see like we have chosen the topic as Swiss Army Knife of Modern Combat. So we can think of a, like a modern warfare, like whatever you can think, like whether it is a cyber security or it's a RF security, it's a hardware security, crypto security, whatever you can come into your mind, everything they most of the organizations, they are using it for the modern combat. And there is a famous saying like by Einstein. Before that, I'll say like, if there will be World War III, then it would lead to the end of civilization. And that's why famous Einstein, he told like for World War IV, if I know what with what weapons World War III will be fought, but World War IV will be fought with sticks and stones. And so let me start with something like EW. Let me explain it what it is. So EW, which is commonly known as electronic warfare, it is the use of the electromagnetic spectrum in an attack. So this electromagnetic spectrum might include everything from X-ray to visible light to infrared and microwaves, radio waves, for example. And they are all the same thing, but the only difference is in their wavelength. And when we talk about SIGINT, it stands for signal intelligence. So it is basically as intelligence gathering by interception of the signals. Signals are everywhere in the air, so you can intercept those signals. And whether communications between people or from electronic signals are not directly used in the communications. So this is the intro. Harshit, next slide. So here's Harshit. Like his primary area includes RF security, telecom security, and IoT security. And next slide. This is me, Himanshu Mehta. So I also work almost in the same domain as Harshit. Apart from that, I also spend some of my time in the web and mobile application security. And I and Harshit, we share same interest. That's how we collaborated together. Though we don't work for the same organization right now, but we have the same interest. So this is the agenda of our talk. So modern military forces, if you see, they rely heavily on a variety of complex, high technology, electronic, offensive, and defensive capabilities, for example. And electronic warfare is a specialized domain, which enhances many air and space functions at multiple levels of conflict. This session, we are going to introduce attendees about some of the fundamental electronic warfare concepts, strategy, and tactics of signal intelligence and radars and some of the electronic threats. We will also discuss about, like, for example, if you see the agenda, we are going to cover some of the information operations, brief history about electronic warfare. It is very important to understand the history so that you know, like, how this emerged and where you can actually contribute to. Then we'll talk about how jamming works. Then we'll give a little more focus on the cyber warfare. Then we'll discuss about multi-domain spectrum operations. Then Harshit will give you very nice case studies about the IED and drones, how they work and how you can protect against those attacks. And then we'll give some glimpse about the future of war, how it might look and where we can contribute more. Next slide. So this is the acronyms that we are going to use very frequently in the presentation. And I ask you, like, if you want, you can take the screenshot. And sometimes, like, if you cannot get something, like, you can refer to that particular screenshot. Yeah, next one. So, okay, Sun Tzu, many few people will be aware about him, but this quote is from the 6th century Chinese general Sun Tzu, who told, like, it has never been more relevant than in the 21st century. Military operations today are being undertaken via smartphones as much as it is using conventional forces. So if you see, like, today's wars are not fought by tanks, aerial bombers, or daring infantry charges. battles in the 21st century are fought in the cities, college campuses, internet forums, and social media news feed. So you can think like nowadays, like a well-timed tweet, for example, or an errant Facebook group, or a seemingly harmless WhatsApp forward, they can hold the potency to be even more dangerous than the artillery fire and air strikes. So while the above may be considered like a stretch or radical statement, but it does not hold water. Okay, so in today's information-dominated security landscape, a man with a smartphone has the capability to organize widespread hate, radicalize youth, manipulate public opinion against a country's own military action, and this might cripple a nation's ability to fight a conventional conflict. Okay, so people are using social media platform also for the same thing. So you can think like this information warfare will not take much time for this, but it's important to understand like what information warfare is before we proceed to electronic warfare, which is the subset of same. Okay, so every day you will see like there is a war taking place on devices you carry in your pocket. We are most certainly at the white hot center of information warfare. Okay, there has been plenty written about this and I won't reiterate it, but I do want to share that this war is far more aggressive, strategic, and frankly successful than you can ever imagine. This new war isn't about capturing land as in previous conflicts, which we see usually, but instead in this information war, the territory being won is the human mind. So everyone is playing with the human mind in this case. Next slide. So this is a basic image which explains the activities that usually the army organizations conduct in information operations. This is just general picturization. It is not relevant to any particular organization. Okay, so you can think like the activities which are mentioned over here are to support the information operations, including acquiring, using, protecting, managing, exploiting, and denying information and infosys. So in this case, like these activities take place within three interrelated components of information operations. So this is basically a picture which depicts the information operations, which contains the operations, relevant information, and intelligence and infosys. And these components operate within a battle space established by the military information environment. So army organizations, if you see, like will usually they conduct these IO activities as part of a dynamic iterative process to support each component in an integrated full dimensional operation. Next. Next slide, Harshit. No, previous one, sorry. Yeah, so if you see here, like there are basically six things that it shows, like information operations it shows, like it involves like acquiring, using, protecting, exploiting, denying, and managing information and infosys, like we explained earlier. And when effectively executed, these critical activities will supplement the human skills of battle command, speed decision making, minimize or eliminate uncertainty, and it will mainly focus on the combat power to help protect the force and harness organizational capabilities. So it's very important for the military to work on these particular skills. Like first one, like if we give a glimpse about acquire, so commanders usually they must consider the nature of the information required before allocating resources to acquire it. Like initial questions which might come into mind when acquiring, like what in particular information is needed? What is the nature of that information, for example? Or how can that information be acquired? And then second area comes the use, how the commander is able to see this battle space through the use of space, air, ground systems to acquire relevant information and provide a current situation. So next one is manage. And in order to conduct full dimensional operation, information and infosys, they require careful coordination and synchronization. So if you see here with guidance issued over here, the staff coordinates and integrates information requirements and infosys to synchronize the critical information flow with the operational concept. And the operational requirements guide the management of this particular EMS, and the principal functions that require planning and control are basically, you can think of like communication, whatever the communication is happening, intelligence collection, jamming, which Harshit is going to discuss further, and some of them might include like resolving electromagnetic interferences. Next one is protect. So while the proliferation of the information and information technology can be a great advantage, it is also a potentially significant risk that must be accounted for in every operation. Okay, so for to protect it, the soldiers and the equipment, some equipments might not be new. Okay, so but they have the significant risk that might be accounted in every operation. Okay, so if you see the increase in importance in today's information rich environment, so some of the friendly information and Infosys must be protected throughout the battle space. So what commander does, he next uses the exploit, and in exploit they try to take the full advantage of any information that has come to hand for military operational purposes. Okay, and the exploitation might involve some of the basic steps like reading the adversary's signals, intercepting the communications, analyzing the signatures, extracting from databases, establishing the order of battle, and taking action to deny, degrade, or manipulate those information capabilities. Then last one is the deny, where they can tell that offensive aspect of IO C2 attack and makes possible the goal of attacking an adversary simultaneously at all levels of the overwhelming force. Okay, next one. So this image basically shows the different levels of war. We will not go much in details, but basically it contains the strategic, operational, and tactical stages. Okay, so in a strategic level, you can see like as with nuclear warfare, nations may eventually develop IO capabilities, like information operation capabilities, that are perceived to be principally offensive or defensive. Okay, and at operational level, IO occurs across the full range of operations and are critical to the success of each stage of the force projection. So whatever they are planning, everything is happening at operational level. And then at the tactical level, the commanders, they will try to usually accomplish their missions through combined arms operations. And at this level, IO are often limited in scope. Next one. So in this slide, you will see like we try to explain about intelligence, surveillance, reconnaissance, and target. So the military world is awash in acronyms, if you see, to the point where many civilians, including those with the technical backgrounds, can feel like they need to learn a whole new language when working on defense-related projects. So intelligence, surveillance, reconnaissance, and targeting. As a concept, it is not very much complicated, and once you know it, you can see just how essential it is to modern military affairs. So let's break down each of the components of ISR and T. So first one is like intelligence. So in intelligence, you can think of it as like it is the actual data which is collected in the field by humans on the ground, sensors, hacking, or some other means, which is then sent back to the command and control, like which we explained earlier, like C2. For analysis and presented to decision makers. So this is very important step, intelligence. Then comes the another stage, which is like surveillance. In surveillance, like you can think of it as like it is the act of monitoring behavior and communications to gather intelligence. And surveillance can be carried out in many ways, like such as audio, video, for example, cameras, microphones, wiretapping, for example. And it might be through like digital, like big data collection, and many more examples can follow. Then comes another one like reconnaissance. You can think of it as like similar to surveillance, but with one major difference. Like reconnaissance is all about gathering intelligence from the field in areas outside the control of friendly forces. So this means like sending human agents, for example, or sensors of some kind into enemy territory to gather vital information. So you can think of like many countries, they try to catch the spies. Okay, so almost all the countries will have their spies in other countries. Okay, so you can think of they are there to do the reconnaissance. And a perfect example of reconnaissance in action would be camera equipped UAVs, which provide real time video feeds of hostile territory and targets. Next one is targeting. If you say like as the name implies, the process of utilizing the intelligence gathered to select a target to strike, as well as what weapons systems to use, like whatever depending on the target, you will decide what weapon you are going to use there, because that is what Harshit might be explaining you, like what radars can be capable of, and how you can bypass those things, how drone attack can be done, or how we can protect against drone attacks, for example. Next one. So we will just give a brief history of electronic warfare, because you know, it's been centuries that we have been using this for the war between countries. Like, so if you examine the history, it becomes almost incredible that we would not have anticipated our great social media platforms to be infiltrated and weaponized against us. But if you see, the history proves here one thing, okay, that it is that history repeats itself. History is one way to predict future risk, and you can see like patterns which are emerging that can help us to be wary and mindful of risk. And disinformation is just one front on which modern warfare is based. So let us see like what are the some of the significant history about electronic warfare, and then we'll go much deeper dive into that. Next one. So we try to highlight few of the key significant incidents, okay, that has happened in the early days of basic signal intelligence and has covered a wide variety of technologies and use cases. Okay, so if you see, first one is Russo-Japanese War, which happened in 1904, and this is actually the birth of signal intelligence. So you can see it's almost more than a century, you know, more than 100 years back, this signal intelligence already started. So what Japan did, Japan was able to intercept and analyze the Russian naval transmissions, which played a significant part in the eventual Japanese victory. And these first true combat intercepts highlighted both the potential of this new source of intelligence and the importance to secure communications. And if I talk about 10 years later, then there was invention of some of the British signals intelligence. Okay, though, so there was no organization in the UK responsible for producing intelligence from intercepted communications prior to 1914. But the need to protect British official communications was already understood by them. And so what happened that they actually understood like what might be possible. So during the Boer War, which happened in 1914, the army had some success in reading encrypted messages. So if you see like some messages were transferred from one place to another place, and those were used by the encrypted Enigma machines, for example, and then it followed, rest followed. Okay, so we will not go much deeper into that. So then if you see 1940, the Battle of Britain, okay, so it was actually the turning the tide with radar, which we are going to discuss in later slides. So using a new breakthrough in radio transmitters, the resonant cavity magnetron and detectors arranged at higher heights and angles to pick up the reflected radio waves bouncing off enemy aircraft, for example, RAF fighters, could be quickly directed to intercept. Okay, so what happened with this particular technology? It proved vital in winning the battle and firmly established radar as a must-have military technology. So from 1940, all the countries thought like radar is a must-have military technology, and that's why you will see now radar used by most of the countries. Then in 1952, some industrial scale jamming came into place. The Soviet Union fought an electromagnetic war on the home front throughout the Cold War, using radio jamming on an industrial scale in an unprecedented effort at mass censorship. And before this particular program came to an end, it started in 1952 and it came to an end in 1980, but there were more than 1700 stations, if I remember correctly, were operating with an estimated combined output of almost like 45 megawatts and costing tens of millions of dollars a year to run. During that time, it was huge money. And then came 1962, where Cuban Missile Crisis, we saw like how the deceptive drones worked. And so if you can consider it like they used to be equipped with an early form of electronic deception. Drones narrowly missed some featuring in one of the Cold War's hottest moments. Yeah, the plan was to unmanned Ryan model. They were fitted with some of the drones and to overfly the island, and drones would carry signal generators that made them seem the size of like spy plane, which are very, very small in size. But later on, they used this for though the project was cancelled, but the UAV soon saw action over Vietnam. Next one. Okay, so this is like electronic warfare when it went to the sea in Battle of Latakia 1973. You will think of it as like it was little action which marked two important milestones in maritime history, being both like first might be the naval engagement missile between missile boats and the first to feature electronic warfare. And then came the US invasion of Panama in 1989, which was like stealth aircraft attack. And in 1989, what happened, like radar defeating technology passed a particularly important milestone with the first combat use of stealthy aircraft, two F-117 Nighthawks, which they were able to evade enemy detection and bomb Rio Hato airfield during the US invasion of Panama. Then came the famous Gulf War in 1991, which is also known as GPS at war. So what happened, like with target tracking and smart missile guidance, the Gulf War highlighted the susceptibility of GPS to jamming, with even some relatively unsophisticated devices proving capable of masking the weak signal from the system's satellite. So GPS, you know, like still remains vulnerable to jamming and spoofing today. You can try it at your home. And then came the very famous like Stuxnet in 2005, which weaponized the cyberspace. So if you know, like Stuxnet is a malicious computer worm that caused significant damage to the Iranian nuclear program. And it is believed to be a joint US-Israeli development even before Edward Snowden explicitly said it in 2013. It is arguably the world's first true cyber weapon. Okay. And in 2018, like then the quantum technology came into light. So you can see here, it can be actually game changer across the whole world of electronic warfare applications, but who leads this war will be very interesting to see. Harshit, up to you.
So imagine you are a military officer in World War I. Armies have grown so large, you can no longer communicate just by the sound of your voice or the wave of your hand. You need to synchronize movements of troops and artillery far and wide. So World War I is frequently referred to as the first modern war, since a number of technological inventions made their debut during the war. Machine guns were introduced, as were tanks, radio, military aircraft. So the army started the war using telegraph over wires, but they soon discovered disadvantages, as messages being sent on them could be intercepted and troops were traced back by following the cables network. So the use of aircraft and tanks also posed new conundrums. The solution was radio. So all of a sudden, warfare had become mobile and it was not possible to communicate with moving tanks and aircraft without radio. In those days, they had to just turn a dial, enter in a frequency and press a button to speak, which also led to security threat of message interception. During the later years of war, new and improved communication and electronic devices came forth from research and development in ever increasing number, which changed the nature of war forever. So here in these three images, you can see the history, how we used to the radio in previous wars. So radio technology has become extremely important in today's world. The applications is like air traffic control and navigation. We use it for military purpose, in astronomical and meteorological study, for law enforcement purposes. So continuously growing amounts of uses, clearly radio is important for many reasons. So in 1940, the US Navy developed the acronym Radio Detection and Ranging, which is radar as we know it today. So radar is a radio wave based technology that is used for detecting physical objects rather than transmitting messages. It works in a similar way to echolocation used by animals like bat. A radar system uses a magnetron to generate radio waves and broadcast them through an antenna, which serves as a transmitter. These waves reflect off objects in the environment and bounce back to the antenna, which doubles as a power receiver. So the antenna repeatedly switches back and forth between transmitting and receiving by means of a duplexer. Now, radar can be classified into different categories, such as pulse radar and continuous wave radar. So they are used to previously, but in current generation, we use active electronically scanned array, which are considered as phased array system. It consists of an array of antennas which form a beam of radio wave that can be aimed in different direction without physically moving the antenna itself. AESA systems are currently used on many different military platforms, including military aircraft and drone, to provide superior situational awareness. The top four advantages, if we talk about AESA, it is resistance to electronic jamming, which is one of the major advantages of an AESA system. Its high degree of resistance to electronic jamming techniques. Radar jamming is usually done by determining the frequency at which an enemy radar is broadcasting and then transmitting a signal at that same frequency to confuse it. Over time, engineers developed a way to counteract this form of jamming by designing radar system which could change their frequency with each pulse. The second advantage is low interception, which is AESA system also have a low probability of intercept by an enemy radar warning receiver. If we talk about the third advantage, it is increased reliability. Yet another benefit, which is is that each module operates independently. So a failure in single module will not have any significant effect on overall system performance. So AESA technology can also be used to create bandwidth data links between aircraft and other equipment. Other advantage is multi-mode capability. So let's talk about the electronic warfare, which is any action involving the use of electromagnetic spectrum or directing the energy to control or attack the enemy or impede enemy use of EM spectrum. So the purpose of electronic warfare is to deny the opponent the advantages of and ensure friendly, unimpeded access to the EM spectrum. So EW can be applied from air, sea, land, or space by manned and unmanned systems and can target human communication or radar or any other assets, which is like for military and civilian purposes. So military operations are executed in an information environment increasingly complicated by the electromagnetic spectrum. The need for military forces to have unimpeded access to and use of the electromagnetic environment creates vulnerabilities and opportunities for electronic warfare in support of military operations. So within the information operations, EW is an element of information warfare. More especially, it is an element of offense and defense counter information. So here you can see in this particular image, electronic warfare is categorized in three categories, which is electronic attack, electronic warfare support, and electronic protection. So we will be talking about these three in details. This was previously, but in current generation, we have a new name for this, which is for ES electronic support. We call it as electronic warfare support. Other name is electronic support measures. For electronic attack, we have electronic countermeasure is a new name. And for electronic protect, the new name is electronic countermeasure. So it might be possible that when you are reading, face some different names. Now, when we talk about electronic support, so it is the main function of it is to detect, intercept, identify, locate, or to localize sources of unintended or intended radiated electromagnetic energy. So intelligence, surveillance, and reconnaissance, as Himanshu talked about, these all three and comes under these particular terms. The purpose is to provide immediate recognition, prioritization, and targeting of threats to battlefield commanders. So signal intelligence, which we also acronym as SIGINT, is related process of analyzing and identifying intercepted transmission from sources such as radio communication, mobile phones, radar, or microwave communication. So SIGINT covers electronic intelligence and communication intelligence in itself. Analysis parameters measured include frequency, bandwidth, modulation, and polarization. So in this image, you can see there's a hard kill or the aircraft is somewhat behind, but it's showing its position of a different position. So on a radar, the position will be different. To unlock this, like if any missiles is locked, then we can use a flare, infrared flare, to miss so that the missile misses the target. Then again, we can radiate at high power, so to noise or deception jamming. We can use the flare or chaff echoes to to escape the radar receiver. In electronic attack, which is also known as electronic countermeasure, it involves the offensive use of EM energy, directed energy, or anti-radiation weapons to attack personal facilities or equipment with the intent of degrading or neutralizing or destroying enemy combat capability, including our human life. So in the case of EM energy, this action is most commonly referred to as jamming and can be performed on communication system or radar systems. So in the case of anti-radiation weapons, many times these include missiles or bomb that can home in on a specific signal, radio or radar, and follow that path directly to impact, thus destroying the system broadcasting. So if we take an example, so ELINT, where we use foreign non-communication electromagnetic information, or the communication intelligence, which is like a foreign communication transmission intercepted by other than the intended recipient. So four classes of electronic attack is, one is the jamming, then modifier, we use radar absorbing materials, then physical destruction. While in a non-destructive electronic attack, we have like a jamming, noise, spot, we can use chaff or flares. So we will not go in much detail about the mechanical solutions. In electronic protection, which is electronic countermeasures, involves action taken to protect friendly forces, which is like personal facilities and equipment, from any effect of friendly or enemy use of the electromagnetic spectrum that degrade, neutralize, or destroy friendly combat capability. So effectively, it is the ability to defeat electronic attack. Now, flares are often used to distract IR missiles to miss their target. Other examples of electronic protection could include use of chaff, which is like protection against radar-guided missiles, and spread spectrum technologies, so which use frequency list or emission control, low observability. Still, the technology comes under the electronic protection. Here in this image, you can see so many different kinds of electronic protection techniques. This particular is taken from Republic of Singapore Air Force. So there are so many different type of categories which can be techniques can be used. Now, if we categorize all of these in a simple diagram, here you can see electronic warfare can be divided in three categories. One is support, countermeasures, and counter-countermeasure. In electronic support measures, we have electronic intelligence, signal intelligence, communication intelligence. The main purpose of it is to detect, to find the direction, to do analysis, or find identifying the enemy. In electronic countermeasures, we have active and passive two categories. In active, it's like deception or jamming. And in passive, we use some kind of chemicals or mechanical mechanical weapons. While in electronic countermeasures, there is anti-active and anti-passive. So that can be divided in like spot, barrage, sweep. So we will not go in much detail about it. Let's talk about the jamming. So while interference generally describe unintentional form of disruption during wireless communication, jamming describes the deliberate interference with or blocking of such communication. So as the name suggests, jamming antennas are especially used to interfere with radio noise or signals. In electronic warfare, these interferences are meant to disrupt control of a battle. For example, jammers radiate, and the two main categories of jamming techniques are noise techniques and repeater techniques. So it can be further divided into spot jamming, sweep jamming, and barrage jamming, which are three most common types of noise jamming, whereas DRFM jamming is the most common type of repeater jamming. Spot jamming is the form of noise jamming where jamming focuses all of its power on single frequency, so rendering the technique ineffective against a frequency agile radar. The barrage jamming is the jamming of multiple frequency at once by a single jammer. The main drawback of this technique is that the jammer spread its power across multiple frequency, making it comparatively less powerful at a single frequency. So in this example, in this image, you can see a noise jamming, which is the deliberate radiation or re-radiation or reflection of electromagnetic energy with the purpose of impairing the use of electronic devices. So let's say the green here, you can see this is a true noise, and we need to target this particular frequency, the target frequency. We can use an ideal jammer, which will cover just that particular frequency, but in actual we cover some kind of offset as well, just to avoid the hopping, frequency hopping. Because when you will transmit, it might be possible that at that time the it will reach to the receiver. There's some kind of attenuation. So due to attenuation, we will see some kind of offset. So that's why we cover the hopping as well. Now, how do we communicate while there is a jamming? So wireless digital communication system generally employ radio frequency signal to transmit information. This transmitter need to control, convert digital messages represented to bits, represented in bits to RF signal, while receiver convert received RF signal back to digital messages. While on the transmitter side, upon receiving bits from upper layer, the transmitter first modulates them to discrete baseband signal. You can see this particular image. In this, in ally-friendly jamming, upon detecting a transmission, the authorized device can employ proper signal processing techniques to remove the jamming signal from the received or mixed signal. So in contrast, the unauthorized device does not have the secret key and cannot remove the interference introduced by ally jamming signals. So this image further illustrate like where is one ally jammer is presented for simplicity. Assuming the ally jammer, the authorized and unauthorized device are in the same area. As mentioned earlier, the ally jammer and unauthorized devices, including A1, A2, AJ, share a secret key K, and the ally jammer AJ uses a pseudo random number generator with K as a key. So when the unauthorized device E1 transmits signal EX1 to another authorized E3, will be the mixture of both XE1 and some portions of our jamming XJ. So with enough jamming power, the jamming signal from AJ can effectively distort the signal XE1 to at E3. So as a result, the wireless communication between the unauthorized devices E1 and E3 is disabled. Now, how will we communicate if we have our own devices as well? So when A1 transmits the signal XA1 to A2, the jamming signal XJ will also distort the received signals at A2. However, since A2 shares the same secret key with AJ, it can regenerate the same jamming signal XJ using K. So in real time, we have one example. In EA18G, which is from L3 Harris, Groller uses a powerful electronic attack jammer to blind enemy radar and protect allied aircraft during missions into hostile territory. So unfortunately, the very high energy from the jammer also blocks onboard communication. Now they have termed it as INCANS, which collects a sample of the jammer interference and uses that sample to create an anti-interference signal, which it then mixes into the receive path for the protected radio. The result of mixing the interference and anti-interference is that they cancel each other out, leaving only the desired reception. So this is a real-time scenario. Now, this is a real-time example where the Army electronic warfare technology attacks and disables tank. So Army trainers successfully used cyber weapons and electronic warfare technology to thwart a simulated tank assault at a training exercise, which is jointly conducted at the Army National Training Center. The exercise reinforced the need for the electronic warfare and cyber protection technology that is under development by entities such as the Army Rapid Capabilities. These tanks had to stop, dismount, and get out of their protection, so which reduced their mobility. So exercises like this one help determine the technology and equipment necessary to achieve this effect in the field. So if we don't win the cyber and electronic warfare fight, then the next maneuver may not matter because we may not get it. So here you can see the military face a new reality, one with multi-domain challenges. The way military builds its forces, integrates its planning, and synchronizes its operation must change quickly. So in modern military lingo, there are 5 interference-related domains. We can categorize it in like land, maritime, air, space, and cyberspace. So the cyberspace domain is wholly man-made and is ever-changing in the emerging multi-domain reality. So an attack will often come from multiple domains simultaneously. It might be like a jamming of radio and data links, persistent surveillance and long range fires. So even if this is a funny meme, right? What will be the warrior guidance of the future look like? So it's like a cybersecurity guide sitting behind. It will say, "Hey, dude, I'm here. So back here." So when we talk about warfare, we should not ignore cyber warfare. It is the use of digital attack to attack a nation, causing comparable harm to actual warfare or disrupt the vital computer systems. Many countries, including the United States, United Kingdom, Russia, India, Pakistan, China, Israel, Iran, North Korea, so there's endless name, which are using active cyber capabilities for offense and defensive operations. So in terms of cyber, we can categorize these particular things in three categories. One is computer network attack, computer network defense, and computer network exploitation. Now, computer, we cannot talk about all of these things because of a limited time. So computer network attack is something like most people think of when they think of cyber warfare. They envision attack taking down power grid. They envision cars being stopped in their tracks. They envision planes coming down. So those are all possibilities in theory. Now CNA is like the compromise of computer-based assets and manipulating the system. The system can be taken down, data can be modified, resources can be misused for botnets. Or again, we have seen so many different kinds of attacks like ransomware. So they all can be used in military purpose as well. And the good thing to know about is like NATO designated cyber as official domain of warfare. So previously we had land, air and sea. Now cyber is also one of the official domain. And a few months back, space was also designated as official domain. But there's a debate going on. It's like we don't want space to be used for electronic attacks or military purposes. So if we briefly talk about these particular things which we have discussed, this is an era of convergence. Military actions involving the use of electromagnetic and directed energy to control the electromagnetic spectrum or to attack the enemy. While the definitions have little in common, like CO and EW are both based on three roughly similar pillars, which is attack, defense, and support operation. For cyberspace operations, the pillars are defined as offensive cyber operation, which is OCO, defensive cyber operations, as well as the Department of Defense network. So in this image, you can see we have signal intelligence overlap of with electronic warfare, as well as electronic warfare, as well as with computer network operations. So we can broadly classify it. Now, according to the warfare and technology make the perfect partner of destruction. Military innovations from like wooden catapults to nuclear bomb have been transforming the war way. War is waged since prehistoric humans carved arrows from stones some 10,000 years ago. In future, we might be seeing the robot wars or the swarm is coming, like the Department of Defense in 2017 demonstrated a micro drone swarm in California, which consisted of 103 drones collaborating in decision making, adaptive formation or self-healing. So we are also seeing smart weapons like in terms of Internet of Things, IoT devices. So as we examine history, it becomes almost incredible that we would not have anticipated our great social media platform, which is also being used as a kind of weapon against us. So this within NATO, electromagnetic operations involves the deliberate transmission and reception of EM energy in the EME for military operations such as communication, navigation, attack, battle space awareness, and targeting. We can see in this particular figure, electromagnetic operations not only enables operation in each domain, but also provide the threat which link and integrate military forces across the domains into the cyberspace and information environment. So within the electromagnetic environment, electromagnetic operations are conducted by both friendly forces and adversaries. So these electromagnetic operations often lead to contested electromagnetic environment. In addition, these operations often overlap with the EM activities executed by neutral actors, further leading to congested electromagnetic energy. So today, the dependency of military operation upon utilizing the electromagnetic spectrum is now a central facet of almost all military activities, is military forces around the world have integrated EM capabilities into a vast majority of platform systems and unit. So we can see over here, whatever we discussed about the electromagnetic spectrum, this is how the future warfare looks like. There are so many different kind of communication and era of convergence between the cyber, land, naval, air force, space-based satellites. So these all are communicating within each other in so many different way. There are jamming as well as from protection point of view, as well as from support point of view. There are countermeasures as well, which will try to hide itself. So this is an image which you can go and study in details. We can share the link for it. Now let's talk about some of the case studies, which is IED and for which is like improvised explosive devices. Now improvised IED is a bomb fabricated in an improvised manner, incorporating destructive, lethal or intensive chemicals, and it is designed to destroy or incorporate personnel or vehicles. So it has become an increasingly popular weapon of choice for insurgents and small armed forces over the past few decades. A favorite type of IED, which we want to discuss, is based or focused on radio control. These IED are inexpensive, very easy to build or acquire, and very difficult to trace and can be triggered from long distances. So keeping the operator, operators can track it. Now, anatomy, if we talk about the anatomy, this can be further categorized. There are so many different techniques which are based on remote controls. So RECD are an effective strategy when facing a superior or technological advanced military forces. Since RCIED is a relatively simple to make, easy, hidden and very destructive, it has become a preferred weapon of insurgents. So like devices like two-way radio, personal mobile radio, two-way radios like are a common method of command initiation incorporated in IED. Then long-range cordless telephone can be used, mobile or cell phones. So there are so many different ways like wireless doorbell, keyless entry system, car alarms, radio control toys. They all can be used as an IED to trigger the IED. Now, what are the counter techniques and how do they trigger? So IED will differ depending on the role that the users intend them to perform. They may be designed to cause widespread loss of life and destruction of infrastructure. So there are so many different things we want to discuss in this particular slide as well. But due to limited time, let me focus on the counter IED, which is like the efforts are done primarily by military, law enforcement, diplomatic or financial intelligence communities, and involve a comprehensive approach to countering the threat network. So you might have seen like during the whenever any president or prime minister travel, there are some kind of these cars which is using which are used to jam the IED, active IED. Now when we talk about the jam drones or UAV, we know they are the biggest threats in upcoming defense, and we are already facing so many different vulnerabilities due to this kind of drones. So at the beginning, when unmanned aerial vehicles were more than a toy or object of joy, no one realized how it could go in next 10 years. So technology are always ahead, and its power and speed of evolution amaze everyone. So drone is very hard to be detected by naked eye, right? Counter drone technology, also known as CUAS or counter UAV technology, refer to system that are used to detect or disable unmanned aircraft. So as concerns mount around the potentially security threat, drone may pose to both civilian and military entities. So in reflect, why radar miss drones? So we all know, due to their small size, slow moving, due to low cost, they are very difficult to detect, as well as it's very difficult to detect in radar, because it might be confused with some kind of birds as well. So there are these kind of techniques. We can use video based approach, in which there are some video based approach or audio based approach based on the acoustics. Then in RF power, we can detect the RF signature. There are some RF active solutions as well available, or the laser scanner, through which we can detect and we can do the surveillance against the drones. Now there are so different platforms which can be used. Some are the guns which we can fire on the drones, or we can use the anti-tanks, we can use some are the we can use another drone to go and attack the drones. So there are so many different technologies to detect and counter these kind of platforms. Now Himanshu will talk about the future of warfare, and we will conclude in next 5 minutes. Himanshu, over to you.
So okay, I'll not take much time. So if you think future of warfare, you can think of it as like a cyber warfare, information warfare, electronic warfare, command and control warfare, spectrum warfare. So those are just some of the names by which researchers and military experts describe their offensive and defensive actions. And next one. So if you can see, next slide, Harshit. So if you see, there have been many technological advances like computational power, communication networks, sensor technology, space-based assets. Okay, so for when we talk about space-based assets, you can think of like satellites. And the purpose of targeting satellites would be an attempt to disrupt communication of information streams vital for commerce and security. Like you can see, like China, Russia, and other national states possess the capabilities already to do a cyber attack on the higher front. You might have seen in some of the movies like Geostorm. So the threat can be both like kinetic and non-kinetic, and counter space capabilities are emerging in the many countries' militaries. And one trend is towards the development of ground-based and space-based. So soft skill, which is known as non-kinetic counter space capabilities, satellites could also be targeted through electronic warfare like jamming and spoofing. These are the basic terminologies, and microwave weapons, laser dazzling, as Harshit explained earlier, and perhaps most worryingly, cyber attacks. Okay, so cyber attacks, we cannot rule out any of these warfare options, and everything is important for the military to secure. Next one. So what they are doing is like they are most of the militaries like who have a lot of budget, they are implementing the smarter AI for the electronic warfare. And you can see like three closely related defense advanced research projects agency like DARPA programs. They apply artificial intelligence to the electromagnetic spectrum and will likely result in electronic warfare systems with unprecedented autonomy. So the first two, if you see here, like adaptive radar countermeasure, which is also known as ARC, and behavioral learning for adaptive electronic warfare, which is known as BLADE, are considered system programs, and they both are applying the artificial intelligence to the electronic warfare systems. So if you see like in ARC, for example, they aim to enable airborne electronic warfare system to automatically generate effective countermeasures against new, unknown, and adaptive radars in real time. So they keep on learning about the radar systems. And if you see another program like BLADE program, as we explained, they are developing machine learning algorithms and techniques to rapidly detect and characterize new radio threats, dynamically synthesize new countermeasures, and similar to ARC, they provide accurate battle damage assessment based on over the air, and they also can observe the changes in the threat. So there is a very famous dogfight which happened 2 weeks earlier. So it was the world's first dogfight between a real aircraft and an artificial intelligence driven virtual fighter jet, which was carried out again 2 weeks back. So if you see here, donning an augmented reality headset in the cockpit of Burkut 560, which they used as an experimental plane, a veteran F-22 pilot had a dogfight with the projection of a Chinese J-20 fighter. So this is what they are doing nowadays. So next slide. So we will conclude this talk. So we have discussed many topics, but what important is like how we can overcome all these. And so there are many fields to explore within this particular domain. And we should know that war fighting environment will always continue to change. So we have to focus more on the spectrum for operations. We need to learn more of the technologies that is being used by the several military agencies, governments, for example. And also we need to look not only in electronic warfare, but we also have to look in other warfare domains. So if I just add on top of this, like if you remember like Elon Musk and Stephen Hawking were among more than 1,000 signatories of an open letter. Okay, we cannot share that open letter here, but you can check it online, which demanded a ban on the autonomous weapons, which they published in 2015. So there is always a concern, like what if they start attacking themselves or they become overpowered than humans, for example. So these are always the concerns for the countries and militaries. Thank you. So we will move to the question and answer sessions. Okay, so
all right.
So we can see there are so many different questions being asked in Zoom channel. We will connect everyone at the Discord channel. We will collect these different questions from which were asked on YouTube, also on the platform which in which we are hosting, and Zoom, and we will compile and answer all of these questions. And we apologize, like we need to speed up because there are so many different things which we need to discuss about the electronic warfare before giving an overview of it. There is so much things which are happening in an electromagnetic spectrum perspective. So you can reach us at these particular emails or our Twitter links, and we can discuss so many different stuff about it. And surely we will see you at the Discord channel. Thank you. Thank you, Nanoshek, for hosting us.
Thank you, everyone.